own minds. It's a world that is very much dependent on various kinds of mental activities. Okay, so let's see where we're going here, and talk about especially perceptual construction, because it's one thing to act in the world so as to change the world for everybody. It's another thing to just interpret the world in such a way as to make it privately cohere with your own private beliefs. So how do we do that? Okay, we've talked about one way, which is by deploying what are known as constructive processes in perception. Again, the idea here is that the stimulus event is inherently ambiguous. There are lots of different ways to perceive it. You construct a perceptual representation of an object or event by taking information from the stimulus and combining it with pre-existing knowledge and beliefs and expectations to produce a mental representation of that stimulus. And it's that mental representation that guides our behavior, okay? So again, these constructive processes and perception are one way in which we create the reality to which we're responding. When it comes to memory, there are so-called reconstructive processes. In the same way that environmental stimuli are inherently ambiguous, so are memory traces inherently ambiguous. The trace does not provide a complete representation of some past event. In order to remember a past event, we have to take whatever information is contained in a memory trace and combine it with knowledge and beliefs and expectations to produce a mental representation of some event in the past. So this reconstructive activity also allows us to create a private reality, to remember how something happened that may be in a manner that may be different from what actually happened viewed objectively. And then finally, just last week, when I was talking about Kelly's personal construct theory of personality, we introduced Kelly's idea of constructive alternativism, which simply means that by changing the category, the way you categorize an event, by changing the way you construe an event, change the way you think about the event, change the way you are going to behave with respect to that event. So to the extent that we're capable of perceiving an object in different ways, remember an event in different ways, construe an event in different ways, we are able to create the reality to which we respond. Okay, so again, this is just to kind of pick up on what we were talking about last week. The general idea, Kelly's idea, which really antedates all of this, is that how we construe events creates our subjective reality, and it's that subjective reality that leads to our behavior. Okay, that's the general idea here. Okay, so that leads us again, as we introduced in the very first week of the course, to talk about these two aspects of social cognition. Again, the first of these is cognition of social reality, based on the idea that there's a social world out there that we can try to understand through perception and memory and thought processes of various kinds. And the kind of naive approach to the cognition of social reality is that there is a social reality that's out there that exists independent of us. And most of our analyses of social perception and social memory and so on have assumed that that's the case. But there is this other element that involves the creation of social reality, that through perception, through memory, through thought processes, we quite literally construct the social world to which we're going to respond, constructed two ways, through thought, perceptual confirmation effects, and through action, behavioral confirmation effects. Okay, so let's talk about these constructive processes again. Analysis of social construction processes by sociologists, philosophers, even psychologists suggest that there are a couple of different ways in which we construct the reality to which we respond. All of these ways have in common this basic shared premise that we do not perceive the world directly, okay? Instead, we know the world only through our representations of it, okay? We don't have any other knowledge of the world. There are two ways in which you can think about this. As psychologists, so far, we've been talking about what you could call the individual variant on cognitive constructionism, which is that the individual constructs a mental representation of the world in his or her own mind, and that then behaves in accordance with that mental representation. But there is a social variant of constructivism that's quite interesting, which basically says that these cognitive constructions, are not just a product of the individual mind. They are also, to some extent at least, a product of social and cultural forces. It's those products that I want to talk about at the moment. Okay. So again, in psychology, we have this idea that individual minds construct mental representations of reality. But in sociology and so on, we get this distinction that we're going to expand on next time in more detail, between an objective reality that exists independent of the mind, can be discovered as the Enlightenment folks thought through the application of science and reason, and there is this subjective reality that's a product of individual minds operating in some kind of social and cultural context. And the question here, but the point here, is that the subjective reality that actually determines our behavior may not correspond precisely to objective reality as somebody else would describe it. Okay. All of this leads in the 20th and 21st century to the emergence of what some individuals have called a post-Enlightenment stance. The Enlightenment stance was basically predicated on the idea that there are universal truths that can be known by the individual through the application of reason. That is the essence of the Enlightenment stance. But these days, especially since World War II, we've been coping with a challenge to the Enlightenment stance that basically denies that there are any such things as universal objective truths. For example, there are individuals who argue that even scientific knowledge is itself historically contingent. Not just that we didn't know that the Earth went around the Sun before Copernicus or Galileo or whatever, but these guys, the more radical the post-Enlightenment figures, will argue that before Copernicus and Galileo, the Earth actually didn't go around the Sun. That it was only once we realized that the Earth went around the Sun that it actually did. Now we don't have to go that far to understand that there are some essential truths about this post-Enlightenment sense that we have to understand, especially in the context of social cognition. Okay, so for example, the general idea is that naming an object, the general idea behind this post-Enlightenment sense is that we spend too much time thinking that naming objects is a substitute for understanding objects, a position that's known as nominalism. We think that once we've named an object or named a principle or whatever, that we understand it, but not necessarily the case. Rather, what happens in the minds of these post-Enlightenment types is that you kind of build a kind of political coalition around some idea that supports a particular construction of reality, but that political coalition's construction of reality is no more, no less valid than anybody else's. again, because the essence of this post-Enlightenment stance is the denial that there are anything like universal objective truths. Let's look at some examples of this now. Taking a famous example is the example of gender. You would think that something like gender is an objective fact about the world that is in some sense observer independent. The argument goes like this, okay? That we have, each of us, a particular chromosomal heritage. If you've got two X chromosomes, you're female. If you've got an X and a Y chromosome, you're male. If you've got some other kind of combination, you're something else. But basically, your gender is determined by your chromosomal heritage. That chromosomal heritage has consequences for your hormonal endowment. If you're genetically XX, you get a bath of one set of hormones as a fetus. If you're genetically XY, you get another bath of hormones as a fetus. This then leads you to develop what the biologists call the primary and secondary sex characteristics, the nature of your internal and external genitalia, whether you've got a penis or a vagina, whether you've got fallopian tubes or whatever, and also leads you to develop a characteristically masculine or feminine physique. And that your identity of yourself as a man or a woman, as a boy or a girl, your role as more or less masculine or more or less feminine in behavior, and your sexual orientation, your erotic orientation towards men or towards women or whatever, basically all follow from these objective biological facts, okay? That is the story about gender as an observer-independent biological fact. That you're either XX or XY or something like that, and that what your chromosomal heritage is determines everything else, your gender identity, your gender role, your sexual orientation, and so on. This gets challenged, beginning in, again, the immediate post, the post-war period, by thinkers like Simone de Beauvoir, great French philosopher, who wrote a book about the social construction of gender that can be summarized in one sentence from de Beauvoir: one is not born, but rather becomes a woman, okay? That there's nothing objectively biological, observer-dependent about anything that has anything to do with womanhood. Basically, de Beauvoir argued that the biological differences between the sexes, genetically XX versus genetically XY, your hormonal endowment, your physique, whatever it is that you've got, your biological differences between the sexes don't determine your gender or your gender attributes. Whether you're masculine or feminine, or your gender relations, whether you're homosexual, whether you're oriented towards men or towards women. Rather, de Beauvoir argued, all of these gendered attributes, what men and women do, what men and women look like, what men and women are oriented towards, all of that is, as she put it, highly contingent on history and social structure. That is, that despite the fact that gender is a biological fact in the chromosomal sense, what people do about gender, how they identify themselves, how they behave, is something that is not determined by biology, but rather is determined by various kinds of social structures. I focus on this because it is probably the single most famous statement of the social constructivist point of view on reality. The idea that something as basic as gender, as being male or female, masculine or feminine, or whatever, is not an objective biological fact, but rather is highly contingent on history and social structure. So again, the idea here is, de Beauvoir didn't deny that there were genes and chromosomes and all of that, should biological sex is an objective fact, but what you do with biological sex, what you do about gendered, gender identity and gender social relations, none of that, or very little of that, flows from biology, and instead reflects basically social consensus about how males and females are supposed to look, how males and females are supposed to are supposed to behave. So the Western concept of masculinity involves a lot of agency and independence. The Western concept of femininity involves communion and dependence, a lot of concern for other people. De Beauvoir argues that none of that flows from biology. All of that flows from various kinds of choices that people have made about how the genders should, how the sexes should behave, and how they should get along. Here's another example. This comes from Nell Irvin Painter about the social construction of race. In much the same way, people like Painter argue that race isn't a biological construct, that the biological differences between the so-called races are in fact extremely small, but that racial distinctions, like gender distinctions, she argues, are highly contingent on history and social structure. There was a time in the history of this country where the racial relations were kind of characterized by what's known as the one-drop rule. If you had one black ancestor anywhere, right, you were classified as black. We don't do that anymore. You'll remember we talked about the history of the U.S. Census back in the lectures on social categorization, and the different construction of black and white and African-American and so on that have run through history. And Painter actually has this very interesting, but those of you who want some interesting deep reading, a very interesting take on the opposite of blackness, which she calls whiteness, which she argues is also a product of social constructionism. And she has this very very long take on where this notion of whiteness came from. Okay, so the general idea here is that de Beauvoir's take on the social construction of gender and people like Painter's take on the social construction of race epitomize the idea that lies behind the social constructivist views in general, that objective facts really count for very little when it comes to the social world, that in fact, most of our social relations, most of our social interactions have nothing to do with objective reality, but rather have to do with subjective reality. And it's not just the subjective reality that's constructed in individual minds, the way psychologists like myself like to portray it, but rather that the subjective reality is created through a kind of social enterprise in which people collectively decide or choose how to think about various kinds of things, and in that way, decide or choose to construct the social reality that we try to understand with our minds. Exactly how we do that, okay, is something that I can't do in the 2 minutes that are remaining here. So this is as good a time as any to stop, and I'll pick this up on Wednesday. Thank you very much.